also we need to remember a key thing. We are here to serve God and bring Him the glory. He is not here to serve us and to bring us glory. You don't hear that in church very often today. God's number one goal isn't to make you happy. Shocker. It's to bring glory to Himself. That is His number one goal. And we say, well, that's awful egocentric. Guess what? He's God. He can be egocentric. It is all about Him. Not only that, but our number one goal is not to make our lives happy. The chief end of man? To glorify God and enjoy Him forever. We have gotten into our heads that since God is a loving God, that He would never allow suffering or pain into our lives. That is hogwash. And this goes completely against what the Scriptures teach us. We are told in Romans 5 that we should glory in our tribulations, knowing that they produce perseverance. Perseverance will manifest character, and character, hope. What do when we have tribulations? Do we glory in them? We go, oh, it's terrible. How awful it is. And the sad thing is, most of us really haven't faced much of tribulations. We're not told to shun tribulation. We're never told in the Scripture that in this life we will always be happy, that we will never suffer. Paul later in Romans 8 says that indeed we will suffer with Him, that we may also be glorified with Him. He goes on to say that he considers the suffering of this present time not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be received. And he suffered. How many of y'all have been thrown in jail for your faith and beaten and stoned to the edge of death? He faced tribulation. So we must erase this lie that if we are Christians, we will never suffer. You see it on television all the time. In fact, we are promised to suffer as Christians, and if we do not suffer, there's a possibility that we have become friends with the world. We need to keep in check to make sure that we haven't become so lukewarm that the world pats us on the head and go, oh, what a nice Christian. This case with Lazarus is a very similar case to the blind man whom Jesus healed. We see that the disciples asked, who sinned that made this man blind? His parents or himself? Who had sinned that caused him to be blind? No one had sinned to cause him to be blind. What was Jesus' reply? That he was born blind so that the works of God could be revealed in him. And we must remember, it isn't like God's being unfair to Lazarus, and that God's being unfair to the blind man, and God's being unfair to us when trials and tribulations come our way. Do we deserve life? Do you deserve life? Do we deserve the right to see? Do we deserve anything in which God has graciously given us? So why is it when God chooses from His sovereign will to remove one of His gracious gifts, do we become incensed and accuse Him of being unjust? If God chooses to do anything with me to His glory, He is well within His rights. For if I was not one of His, what do I deserve? If I'm not one of His sheep, what do I deserve right now? Immediate death, eternal death, and hell. And because I'm one of His, guess what? I'm no longer a slave to sin, but I'm a slave to God. How many times does Paul refer to himself as a bondservant? A bondservant is a slave. And who has total authority over a bondservant? The master does. And who are we to be bond servants to? Of course, God. The problem with Christians in America today is that we are so used to defending our rights that we begin to think that we can demand things from God. God, you're trampling on my rights. How many rights do we have before God? Nothing. We ain't got nothing. Not a thing. And how foolish of us to demand things from God. So let us remember that we are here to bring glory to God. So when tough times come, it's one of two things. We'll look at this in John 15. It's either pruning to make us more fruitful for Him, or it's discipline because we've gotten way out of His will. We need to pay attention to which one it is. Either one, we need to be able to go through that, giving Him the glory. Lazarus, this was pruning. This was to give glory to God. And let us never be incensed to God. Now Jesus says, walk in the light. He said, Then after this He said to the disciples, let us go to Judea again. The disciples said to Him, Rabbi, lately the Jews sought to stone You, and You're going there again? Jesus answered them, are there not 12 hours in the day? If anyone walks in the day, he does not stumble, because he sees the light of this world. But if one walks in the night, he stumbles because the light is not in him. Now the disciples were clearly worried about Jesus' life. They felt that He was putting Himself into grave danger traveling back to Judea. Was He putting Himself in grave danger? And I mean no pun there, grave danger. But Jesus knew that it was time for Him to lay down His life, as agreed upon with the other two persons of the Trinity and the covenant of redemption. It was a question of who Jesus was going to be obedient to. Was He going to be obedient to His Father's will, or would He be obedient to our natural desire to survive? God has given us a natural desire to survive. You see it in the hospitals when people are really, really, really sick, yet their body fights to live. But who was Jesus going to be obedient to? What was Jesus' reply? It was that there was 12 hours. And if He were to continue past the time of His Father's will, He'd be walking in darkness and would stumble. And that should teach us as well. If we think we are strong and tall, it is only because of God allowing us to walk that way. We know that if we are obedient to Christ, He will light our path and be a light unto our feet. We are told in Psalms 119 that God's word is a light to my feet and a light to my path. That would have been a good song to sing this morning. And who is God's word incarnate? Jesus Christ. So if we are obedient to God's word in every sense of the word, we will walk in the light and not stumble. But if we are disobedient and follow our own ways above God's ways, we will walk in darkness and we will stumble. Which way are you walking? Are you walking in obedience to God and you can see your path is straight and will not stumble? Are you walking in your own ways and being disobedient to God, thinking, I can do this in the dark? Who has got up late at night, didn't want to turn on their light because they might mess or bother someone, and they stub their toe? That hurts. That hurts. I guess I'm the only one that done it.
Who am I that the Lord of all the earth would care to know my name, would care to feel my hurt? Who am I that the bright and morning star would choose to light the way for my ever-wandering heart? Not because of who I am, but because of what You've done. Not because of what I've done,